Neither do you.
And good evening. I'd like to call this regular meeting of the Sholo City Council to order. By roll call, see that all council members are present at this time. Would like to welcome those of you who are with us here tonight in the audience, as well as those who may be watching tonight at home on City 56 or at some other YouTube or other device. We'd like to begin this evening by invocation. We've asked Councilmember Kelly if he'd lead us in the invocation, followed by the Pledge of Allegiance by Councilmember Clark. Those who'd like to join with us, please stand.
Our Father in heaven, dear God, I ask that you be with our nation in a special way tonight. Be with our leaders, our president, the governors around this nation, mayors of our city that are suffering all this conflict. I would ask that you would bring judgment, help these people, help the ones that are in leadership decide how to deal with it, what to do. Help the ones that are being misbehaving and worse to come to their senses. I ask that you be with us tonight in Sholo as this council meets and considers business before us, that you would give us each wisdom that we might handle the situations that are before us tonight in a way that is very best for this city, and that you give us total wisdom. Ask that you continue to bless us with moisture. What a blessing to receive this moisture at this time of year. So unusual. We ask for more because that's the way I am. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Please join me in the pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America.
And to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Councilmember Kelly. Appreciate that prayer. It is very unusual that we do have moisture at this time of year. If you've lived here very long, it's a great blessing that we have in the community. And it's a great blessing that we have, that we have had no unrest due to some of the things that are happening throughout the world and throughout the United States. And may we stand united, thankful for that. We'd like to begin this meeting here. We have call to the public. Any citizen desiring to speak on a matter that's within the jurisdiction of the city may do so at this time. Remind you that your comments need to be limited to 3 minutes. And if we have, so far we have two people who have asked to speak. If there's others, you need to fill out one of these blue cards and this back and give it to the city clerk here. Please state your name and your address when you come up speaking. Your time is limited to 3 minutes, and Vice Mayor will keep the time. Okay? We have the first person here. His ass is Allison Heppner.
You didn't know that, huh?
You start the time after I say my address? Just want to know how much
when
I
you
get.
Sat stood up. Heard it 15 minutes.
Good time.
You wasted your time. So clock is moving.
Oh, darn. So my name is Allison Heffner. I live at 40 South Paloma, right back behind where the high school is. And I'm actually here because I oppose canceling the Freedom Fest. And the reason for that is I've lived in that neighborhood for 10 years now. And then I also, previous to that, was with Sholo Fire when they were here. And we managed the fireworks of that event for almost a decade when I was there. And I've seen the controlled chaos that that event brings to the area. As being a member of the fire service back then and seeing that, there it was done very well. You guys did a phenomenal job. The police did a great job at making sure that people got in and out safely. My concern is living in that neighborhood. If you've ever lived in the neighborhood surrounding the high school, what happens? We get inundated with vehicles and people in our neighborhood, and we have kids in there. So I'm afraid that what this might do in canceling this is increase the traffic flow in our neighborhood. I'm just hoping that you guys have some sort of plan to mitigate anything happening to our children in those neighborhoods and our neighbors. The other thing that I'm concerned about is by canceling the Freedom Fest, what this does is it puts more pressure on our neighboring communities and puts more traffic and chaos in their area. So I'm hopeful that you guys will be able to maybe look at this and at least have a plan to mitigate anything coming out of it. I know that COVID is being taken very serious, and I understand that, but there's a lot of things that are coming out of because of the way we're reacting to it. I've had to deal with more children in our community passing, not because they got COVID, but because of the way we're reacting to it. And I just don't want to see it happen to anybody else. So that's what I'm here to ask you to do, is to please kind of review why you're doing this and if it is the best choice for the areas here.
Okay? Thank you.
Thank you.
Next person we have is Mike Bosley.
Good evening, Council. My name is Mike Bosley, and I live at 680 South Angeles Place, and I own the business The Poor Station, which is located at 360 South White Mountain Road. I come to you wearing two hats once again, and also on that same topic of Freedom Fest. This COVID has really taken a hit to our economy as small businesses up here over the last several months. The Freedom Fest is a huge economic boost for my business, for restaurants in the area. It's really the kickoff when a lot of people come up. They are doing their family summer vacation at that time, especially now that COVID is now starting to phase and we're into phasing back into normalcy of whatever that is. It is huge, and taking Freedom Fest away, I believe that it will lower the tourism that we have over that weekend. We really need that economic boost. It's been horrible. I'm trying to fight to keep the doors open. And that's a huge weekend for me. Taking that off the books really hurts. I also come to you as a citizen. I have quick little mementos for you from several years ago.
Thank you.
Is that you when you were little?
No. This was a cute little girl I took about 2 years ago, a picture of 2 years ago during the parade. She embodies the kids that love this parade, look forward to this parade, and shows the American spirit that we need to stand for right now. Thank you for your time, and please reconsider Freedom Fest.
Thank you. Next person is Bob Schultz.
I'm not drunk. I walk like this.
Hi. Yeah, I was on the same subject. You know, I was really disappointed that we're not going to have a parade, because we really need one this time in lieu of what's going on. You know, for two things, it shows, you know, our American patriotism. Plus, a lot of businesses make a lot of money on this time, you know, so I just wanted to say that. Thank you.
Appreciate it. Thank you. Any other person wants to speak on call to the public? May do so at this time. See, no other. I'm just going to share maybe for some of our people of how this decision came about and why this decision isn't necessarily the decision of the council. Okay, this decision is also takes into effect the situation that we are under, and the situation that we're clearly under is still under the direction of the statement that was given, the executive order by our governor, and he has not lifted the executive order or given us the clearance to be able to have large gatherings. Now, we'll say that there have been large gatherings that we have at our farmer's market, but he's clearly given guidelines for a farmer's market to function. And those guidelines are trying to be followed, and that is approved by the governor's order as part of his executive decision. This decision did not come lightly. It was a decision that was, because it is a longstanding tradition to celebrate our nation's birth with our local citizens. It's also very disheartening not to have this, because this is our 150th year anniversary. There has been nobody who's wanted to have the 4th of July parade more than this council, because it is our 150th year celebration, our sesquicentennial. And we have budgeted for and we've planned for and when we wanted to have a better Freedom Festival, a better parade than we've ever had to celebrate that. But one of our top priorities we have as city staff is the safety of our citizens, the safety of our workers, the safety of our first responders. We have a lot of cases that have developed since we've made this decision and developed recently prior to this decision that was made. If the governor were to change and to change his decision that he stands and there was still time able to put something together, it would then give us an opportunity to decide whether or not we were able to go forward with something. But at this present time, we hear what you're saying. I, as one person, definitely would be in total favor of going forward, but the decision to go and to hold for the safety, we cannot put that at risk at this time. It is a decision that the, not the council, but the decision that staff, our public, our recreation department, I always get confused there, not confused, but the tongue twister there, our Parks and Recreation Division. We didn't take this lightly at all. And we met with our police and with the fire department, and we went forward. Some of the things that you have asked us to, as far as the fireworks, we've changed those so that they will be a higher projectile type of firework, so more people can stay further away from the high school and still see them. We will also televise it on City 56, and we've asked several of our radio stations if they would play patriotic music during this time. And so we're trying to make the best of what we can. We reached out to several other cities throughout the state, and most all cities, Apache Junction, Marana, Scottsdale, Casa Grande, Buckeye, Surprise, Oro Valley, Cooley, San Luis, Flagstaff, Morenci, are the ones who responded that they have canceled all of their festivities other than some fireworks. And so we stand still united as cities and towns. We stand united to support our governor, and we stand united to support the President of the United States. And we just ask you to stand united and support us, your elected officials, because it wasn't their decision, okay? It wasn't something that we're making law or ordinances that's brought before this council to vote or to do. And every one of them would have liked to weigh in on the decision. But we do hire a city manager. We do hire our Parks and Recreation and those people there. Yes, I was part of that decision as well, and I supported their decision, because it was made on the basis of safety first. And so we want to do that, and we do want to respect our flag and our country, our constitution and our laws. So thank you very much for that, and I appreciate you letting me share how that decision was made. Thank you.
Can I share one thing?
Yes.
Chief, is there any way that we can just give this to you to look at those subdivisions and see if we can protect some of those subdivision for us?
Okay.
No, I'm just, you know, just give it to him so he can do it.
We have had meetings, and they are aware of that and working towards that. But thank you. Next, at this time, I'll close call to the public and come back to special events. Tonight, we have recognition here. And I don't know, Mr. Burr, if you'd like to come up as well with one of our longtime city employees here that we have. You want to introduce your employee here? Mr. Cup, he as well.
I'm not going to take very much of your time. I just wanted to say thank you to AC. I'm going to turn this over to Tom and to AC, because anyone that's ever had a conversation with AC knows that we might have a late meeting tonight. So, all joking aside, thank you very much.
No regrets.
No good. AC, on behalf of the Sholo City Council, would like to present this clock so you have time to continue doing 25 more years. So thank you.
Use a clock.
We're not going to shake hands tonight, but thank you so much. Mr. Burr, would you like to make a comment here tonight?
Yes, I would.
I'm a paid spokesman here.
I would really just want to say thank you to AC for all he's done for the airport and for the community here. A lot of what he has done has been behind the scenes, especially during times when things have been hectic in town during fire season. He's been there without a lot of recognition to help keep our community safe through fueling those firefighting aircraft. And want to say thank you. I've only known him for three of those years out of the 25 plus he's been here, and they've been great. It's been a pleasure to get to know him and to be able to work alongside with him. So thank you.
I want to thank Gene Kelly with a lot of help with the fire, and the HR was excellent. Connie was running it, and it is today.
If I may, Mayor, I want to tell a story about AC and his dedication to the city of Sholo. Years ago, when I was the HR director for the city, I got a phone call late at night trying to identify this crazy person that was out in a foot and a half of snow. It was snowing like crazy, still coming down. And AC was on call that night, and he was riding his bicycle through the middle of town trying to get out to the airport to do his duties that he was to do that night. And so
that was my car, so.
But they called me to identify that he was definitely worked for the city, and
good exercise.
He was okay to be out on his bike.
That's
in the
good.
Middle of the night.
AC, thank you so much. I appreciate that. 25 years of service.
No problem. It went
awesome.
Fast.
Appreciate
thank
it.
You.
And
thank
I'm
you.
Glad to be in Sholo.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Tonight we have, we're grateful for our planning and zoning. It seems that when projects come before the city and council, before many projects are seen by us, they're looked over and adjustments are made and things are decided and recommendations are made to the council. And it's a very integral part of the city is our planning and zoning. And we want to appreciate a couple of council commissioners who have moved on. One is Kathleen Babrans, who's not able to be with us tonight. We appreciate her, but we have a certificate of appreciation. She served from December 2012 to March of 2020. And so she served for 8 years here with the city. Thank you, Kathleen. Next one we have is Mr. Brant Clark. It says that Brant Clark served on Planning and Zoning Commission from June 2014 to March 2020. And then he had an ambition to become a council member. So, yeah. Mr. Clark, thank you. Congratulations. Thank you for service there.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Do you want to go back yet? Or are you
no. Okay, I like this seat a lot better.
Next item we have is a presentation regarding wildfire mitigation by APS. Mr. Neil Trapper, thanks for being here tonight.
Well, thank you for letting me be here. Mayor, Vice Mayor, Council members, thank you for letting me be here. I get an opportunity to come and present every now and again, and I enjoy being in the council, the chambers here in Sholo. It's great. And tonight I come to talk to you a little bit about fire mitigation and something that I talk about every year about this time and some operational protocols that APS has been putting in place to ensure the safety of our employees, our customers, and in the communities. And so I just want to talk a little bit about some of the things that we've been doing over the past few years to mitigate the potential for our equipment for starting fires. So APS has a comprehensive fire mitigation plan is what we call it. And as you are likely aware, safety and reliability are the most important things to APS. So as a part of that, we have created a comprehensive fire mitigation plan. It's multiple different facets, and I'm going to talk just very briefly about each one of them. The first one would be our integrated vegetation management program. And this program is that we actually patrol our lines, our distribution feeders and transmission feeders every year, go along them and ensure that we do proper pruning, mechanical clearing of the transmission and distribution lines. And I know here in Sholo in particular, over the last couple of years, we've cleaned up a lot of trees that were getting close to our lines. And the idea there is to ensure that we don't have any contact with any fire, any type of vegetation to potentially cause a fire. Another one is a program that we've implemented over the last couple of years called defensible space around poles. And what that is around any pole, distribution pole that has equipment on it, so a transformer or a regulator or a cap bank or any kind of equipment on it, we actually go around the base of that pole and clean a 10-foot space around that pole. And the reason for that is if there were a potential failure of that piece of equipment, anything that would fall to the ground would fall on bare dirt and not potentially cause a fire. The next one would be our line inspections and safety inspections is what we call them. And the purpose of that is we patrol over 2,800 miles of distribution feeders every year to ensure that there's nothing coming in conflict with our poles, that our poles and equipment are in good working repair so that nothing has a potential to actually cause a spark or a fire there. The last one is another one is operational protocol. As in previous years, APS is continuing to our operational protocols as a part of fire mitigation measures. And what does that really mean for us is on our poles, a lot of our equipment that we have, we have equipment that actually senses faults on the line. And when it senses a fault, it'll turn off the power just momentarily. For example, a Mylar balloon comes and hits a power line, or a tree branch falls and catches a power line. It'll turn the power off just momentarily, let the branch fall through or the Mylar balloon blow up and float away, whatever it may need to be. And then the power turns back on. So it's an operational piece of equipment that ensures reliability for us. Well, during fire season, which we just barely went into for our purposes just a couple weeks ago, we actually turned those pieces of equipment off. And the reason for that is that if there was a branch to come through and actually sever the power lines, we don't want to push power back into a line that has potentially fallen to the ground and could ignite a fire out in the middle of the forest or something. So we actually turned those off. And then the last piece is that we're reaching out and doing more additional customer communication. This is one of those. I'm here visiting with the members of Sholo so that the citizens of Sholo understand that there's a potential because of these operational protocols that we've modified, that any outage that occurs over the next month or so until the monsoons really pick up here, that there's a potential that the outages that would normally be just a very rapid blink on the line, you wouldn't notice, could potentially be a little bit longer, a couple of hours, maybe even longer than that, while we actually put somebody out in the field and confirm that there's nothing on the ground, there's no branch in the way that's going to cause sparks, there's nothing hanging in our wires that could potentially cause a fire. And it's a great program. It's something that's really, the communities, I think, are very much so on board with it. It's a challenge for us because we love having the power on, and sometimes we got to have the power off to ensure that we're operationally sound and we're safe. But I think overall it's been a great program. It's been very successful for us. We definitely don't ever want to have Sholo turn into what happened in California over the last couple of years. It's a beautiful community. We all love living here and being a part of the community. And I can tell you, we're going to do anything and everything we can to ensure that this community survives and that we don't have another mega fire like the Wallow Fire, Rodeo Fire, Chedeschi Fire. So that's really what I'm here for tonight, just to share that message with you. We just went into our operational protocol modifications just last Friday, previous Friday, and it'll go until we work with the Forest Service, and Forest Service says we're getting enough water on the ground, there's not a lot of fuel for potential starting a fire, so we'll let them kind of help make the decision for us, and we work with them frequently on those types of things. But that's really why I'm here tonight, to let you know about what's going on and let you know that is an active thing here in the city of Sholo because of the pine trees, because of the forest lines we have in the forest around. So it may affect directly the city of Sholo. That's why I'm here talking to you tonight.
Thank you.
I'll end with that. And if you have any questions, let me know.
Any questions of the council at all? Comments? I'm going to say we need to probably, talk in budget here a little bit about the way you guys sculpture trees. We should maybe have the best tree that's left behind after you guys have mastered some of those beautiful landscape cut trees, that we should maybe vote on it and give you guys an award.
If you'll take a poll, I'll take that back to my forestry department and let them know which one wins the award.
Yeah. I understand you guys are all about just keeping it safe, but it's interesting enough today, or yesterday, we had a meeting with the fire chief of Pine Top Lakeside. And as far as our rating here, we are higher than what California was as far as the potential of a major fire like they had. And that fire devastated a large part of California. So we appreciate what you do to try to be fire wise and try to keep us as safe as possible. And we appreciate APS and your partnership with the city.
You're more than welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next item we have is a presentation of changes to the fiscal year 2021 city manager's recommended budget for fiscal year ending June 30th, 2021. Mr. Johnson.
Thank you, Mayor. Good evening, Mayor, Vice Mayor, Council members. Tonight we have prepared just a brief presentation to review some of the changes that we needed to make since we made our last presentation of the city manager's recommended budget. This is a recap of our calendar for our budget process. We did have to move some of the dates. Normally we would be adopting our tentative budget at this meeting, but with the uncertainty with the revenues and the economic situation, we decided to push that out so we can still get the final budget adopted before it's legally required to be adopted, but we did have to move some dates. So tonight we're here to just review the changes that were made to the city manager's recommended. On our budget versus actual, in the blue on the chart, you'll see the budgeted amount for the fiscal year listed below. And then you'll see in red what we actually expended for that budget. This year, our budget with the adjustments that we've made since our city manager's recommended was presented is around $60 million. And we'll go through some of the changes that were made to that budget. So when we first presented the recommended, we were at $43,900,000. We did have some modifications there on the revenue side. Keep in mind that the state doesn't really mandate what's going on with the revenues. They're more concerned with the expenditures, but we are required to deliver a balanced budget. So we did have some modifications that were made at around $694,000. The majority of those are about $415,000 revenue carryovers, community services, and a new grant, $243,000, increase in general fund subsidy to cover local match on new grant projects. So that's the bulk of the $694,000. In this slide, we also have our unbudgeted reserves. When permanent base was passed in 2016, there was a voter mandate that we keep $1 million in reserve as city staff, and we worked with the council and the mayor to determine that we're trying to get to 3 months of operations in our reserves, so we're striving to be 3 months in the general fund. And the water, we are there, and the wastewater, we're close, we're not quite there, we're over 2 years in reserve. And then we've built up a reserve for the future water treatment plant, depending on what our needs may be. That could be drilling a new well, or it could be a treatment plant. Here's a further breakdown of the revenues in our fund balance. You'll see the increase there from $22.8 million to $26.5 million. Most of that increase is a result of project carryovers. When we don't complete projects in a fiscal year, we don't know for sure that we're going to complete them. We'll carry those projects over to the next year to make sure we have funding to complete. We still have opportunities to finish some of those projects in the current fiscal year, and if we do, you'll see that number change and it will go down. In our operating revenues, slight change there, and then on the operating transfers, that was due to some additional grant projects with local funding requirements. On the expenditure side, we'll get into the details of this. On project specific, which I won't go into the details of every project, but we'll give a list for the council to quickly look at, and we can answer any questions on that. So modifications here at $4.4 million. We did have some changes there from our last meeting. Some of that was due to potential refunds through the Arizona CARES Act at $1.3 million, which is offset with some additional revenues. And then we also have the South Apron construction at the airport and increase in water capital and carryovers. And just as an FYI, for our fiscal year 2020 budget, we were at $52.6 million, and for 2021 we're at $60 million. and the bulk of that increase is due to the project carryovers. Next, we'll take a look at some of the items that we will be carrying over because we weren't able to complete them in this year, and or we're not sure yet. And once we have some time between our next presentation, we'll get with Public Works and the different departments and review the capital carryovers and see if they're going to be completed by June 30th or not. But this is a page one of a list of a couple pages just to review and show you why the budget was revised. This on page two, we have some items that were carried over, just like on the previous. And any questions on those, we can try and answer for you. But the total of all the carryovers there is the $3.183 million. Breakdown of some other expenditure modifications that we had to make in general operations. That is where we've created the line to accommodate any potential refund that we get from the Arizona CARES Act. We've applied for money. We're not sure how much we'll get. The maximum amount, according to the information we got from the state, is $1.3 million. And then we also have some other changes there. One example is the carrying over the fishing lake, Cholo Lake fishing piers, and that's $100,000. Any questions on the project carryovers? A few additional comments. As staff, we'll continue to be in touch with the league and monitoring our sales tax revenues and other revenues and keep in touch with what's going on in our local economy. We still have time to make adjustments if we need them. Our plan is to have the council adopt the tentative budget at our next meeting on June 16th, and we can make changes from the time of the adoption of the tentative as long as we don't make any increases. So we still have opportunities to make changes. If we see things that need to be reductions that need to be made, we can continue to do that up until the final budget adoption. As in years past, we will create a deferred list. And what this is we identify several large projects that are probably not going to happen until the next spring anyways. And then if revenues are coming in, we'll proceed with the projects. If we're not, we'll hold off to make sure we can maintain our budget levels. And another item that we wanted to highlight is that the recreation staff is planning to move their activities over to the aquatic center, so staff will be moving over there. What had happened is during the budget process, there was a request for some additional personnel, and we asked the recreation staff and the community services director to come back to us with a few options, whether it meant adding people or maybe restructuring, and the staff came up with the idea to provide more support to the aquatic center manager by having recreation staff in the aquatic center to provide more support. So it's no impact to the budget. It's just something we wanted to make the council aware of. And then the other thing that we just found out late this afternoon, we got our estimated state share revenues from the league staff, and they're estimating about $240,000 reduction in the state share revenues. So that's around 5%. The initial number was 5.5 million, and now it's closer to 5.2. So we feel like we can accommodate it in the current budget, but we want to make the council aware of that, and we'll have more solid numbers next time we meet.
Is that a reduction based on the state feeling that they're going to have a reduction in their revenue strictly?
Correct. Okay, and so it's guesswork at this point. Nobody's really seen final numbers for April. We did have a slowdown starting the end of March, but that was only 10 days or so for the full month. So once they have April numbers, they'll probably be able to get a more accurate estimate for that.
Okay. Thank you. Any other questions, comments? Yeah, Councilmember Leach.
Just real quick, because you brought up the Cholo Lake fishing docks, and I just need clarification on our Fool's Hollow. I know we have fishing game. I know there's partnership in that whole thing, but the fishing docks, I don't know who's in charge of them, but the fishing docks at Fool's Hollow have been broke since last year, and they're still broke this year because apparently nobody has the money. So I'm just curious of, is that some of our responsibility? Should we be looking at that, or who should be looking at that? I was just over there even the long weekend, and they were still broke because of they detached from the cable or something, but they don't have the money. And I know we're in partnership with that, and they're not being used. And this is going on the second year. They were broke last year as well. So it just when you brought the Shoal Lake thing up.
I'll have to defer on that one. I'm not
sure. I kind of figured, so I just figure if we can get that fixed.
Okay, the city owns the fishing docks at Shoal Lake, and we do not have any ownership of ones at Fool's Hollow. We are a partner in the project, and we have an annual meeting with Fool's Hollow partners, and I'm thinking Game and Fish, and between Game and Fish, State Parks are working on some kind of plan on those, but I'm not sure. But we're taking care of the ones that we have ownership of right now.
Last slide I have prepared for the council tonight has to do with the garbage, the sanitation rates. Each year, our contractor, Waste Management, does a study, and the contract allows them to do a fuel adjustment and a consumer price index adjustment. This year, the adjustment with the fuel increase and the CPI is going to be 69 cents per month. And the new rate will be $15.78. We're currently billing $15.09 for your first container and your recycle container. The rate for the extra container will remain unchanged. A couple things I did want to highlight for the council. Last year we did have a similar request for an increase, but the fund balance was in good enough condition that the city absorbed half of the increase. So out of the 60 cents, the fund absorb 30 cents of that, and we'll continue to do that. So we're not piling that on. This is strictly just this year's increase. And like I said, the fee for the additional part will remain the same, and that's at $6.74.
Vice Mayor.
Is this renewed every year, or do they change it every year, or is it a 3-year contract with this, or is it are we just in with Waste Management just to do the garbage collection? Because I'm just trying to figure out how many times this thing could raise up with the public and everything else.
Yeah, so I believe it was a 10-year contract, and it was first signed in 2014. So we've got a few more years left with them.
Okay.
But as a reference point, I have the numbers here that Carrie put together. In 2012, before the contract with Waste Management, we were paying $17.18. So we're actually about $1.50 cheaper now than we were 9 years ago.
Yeah. Thank you for those stats. Appreciate
it. No problem.
Thank you. Good question.
Any questions on the sanitation? That's all I have prepared for the council tonight. Like I said, we'll be back with the tentative budget for adoption on the June 16th meeting, and then the final budget on our only meeting in July 21st.
Vice Mayor.
Justin and Carrie, thank you for all your time you put into this. I know with everything that's been going on these last 4 or 5 months, we knew that there would be some type of changes, and we're glad that you guys stay on top of it and give us an update on that. So appreciate staff for being able to be flexible to try to pick up some of this stuff or lessen the line item that we're looking at. So I thank you for your time and your patience with us. Thank you.
We definitely got a lot of contributions from all departments and city manager's office as well. Like you said, we didn't know what was going to happen. So we asked people about a month ago to give us recommendations for change if we needed to in the current fiscal year and for projects going forward in the future. So we still have that data. Right now, we're looking pretty good with the way the budget's built, but we're ready to move if we need to. So thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Just real quick. Hopefully, when we bring this back for approval at the next meeting, we can throw some of it up there on the screen. It'd been nice having this crowd here to have those figures up there. So hopefully, especially all that list of carryovers that we're reading, it'd been nice to have them up there. So maybe the next one.
Okay. Yeah, we'll definitely do that.
Thank you.
No problem.
Thank you. Thank you. Appreciate it.
That means you all got to come back to the next meeting. Just you got that, right? Okay.
Next item is the consent calendar. Look for council any items that need to be pulled or reviewed on the consent calendar. See none, I'll read what the items are. We have a consideration of the acceptance of grant funds from the Arizona Game and Fish Department Heritage Fund. We have a consideration of the award of a construction contract to Spray Systems. There's a change here that you've been handed out, modified from what was in the packet. Just a slight change that they have made. And then we have the minutes of the April 16th meeting as well as the regular meeting of the May 19th meeting. Need a motion to approve? Mm-hmm. You have a motion by Councilwoman Kakavas. Is there a second? Second by Councilmember Clark. Any other discussion? Call for the vote. All those in favor? Any opposed? See that pass 7-0. Thank you. Next item is new business. We have a consideration of appointment of a planning and zoning commission members. Turn the time to Ms. Reedhead.
Thank you, Mayor, Council. There are currently two vacancies on the Planning and Zoning Commission. Kathleen Behrens has informed staff that due to her some health issues, she is regrettably unable to fulfill her term, which expires March 2021. Brant Clark, whose term expires March 2023, was recently appointed to fill a vacancy on the City Council, so his seat on the Commission needs to be filled as well. Per policy, city staff advertised the vacancies and received applications from four applicants: Bill Bess, James Hoffman, Stephen Douglas Roberts, and Don Wilson. The four applicants were interviewed by the council earlier this evening in a special meeting. In front of you, you'll have a questionnaire with the names of the four applicants. We'll ask you to write your name on the questionnaire and mark two choices for the two individuals that you wish to appoint. Afterwards, Rachel Hall, our assistant city clerk, our deputy city clerk, we need a new nameplate, will tally the results and will indicate who the top two are. And the motion will be made on those results.
This time we ask the council members to make your selection and pass them this way. Do we have a deck of cards?
Told you we needed a deck of cards.
You did.
Huh? Yeah, apparently, I don't think he's serious. Yeah. Suspense.
Okay, the top person here I'd like to welcome is Don Wilson. And then we have a tie between Mr. Roberts and Mr. Bess. And as tradition, we'll have both of them come forward and we will draw for the Deuce of Clubs.
And I see it. It's at the bottom. So it's still at the bottom. By the way.
Don't play poker with Junior, that's for sure.
I have a deuce of clubs right here.
This is a great tradition here.
He should pull his cards like he's done it before, you know that?
Okay, we're going to go with who had the first interview. Gets to draw first. Okay?
He doesn't know how to shuffle cards.
So just draw the top card. Oh. Turn it over. Okay. Drawn and done. You get the deuce. Okay.
How can we? No.
Three of clubs.
Hey.
Eight of clubs.
How do we have a tie?
Three of spades. I'm sorry. Three of hearts.
How do we have a tie with seven?
Four of spades. Mm. Three of clubs. That was close.
I don't think so.
A deuce of spades. Queen. Heart. Ten of diamonds. Queen of spades. Ace. Clubs. It is in here, right?
I've seen it from all the way over here. Diamonds. It's at the bottom.
We have to play all night here. 10 of clubs. 8 of spades. 7 of diamonds.
Oh.
6 of spades. Getting closer. Queen of clubs. Deuce. Okay. Mr. Best. Congratulations.
One by a shuffle or a deck of the cards, huh?
Who won? I was Bill. Talking.
Miss Bess.
Miss Bess.
Thank you both for applying, as well as Mr. Hoffman, who wasn't able to attend tonight. We appreciate that, and congratulations to those who have been selected. We need a motion at this time. To prove them in the position. At this time, Don Wilson would be to serve the longer term and Mr. Best to serve the shorter term at this time. Okay. Councilwoman Kukavas, so moved. Is there a second by Vice Mayor? Any other comments? Look for all those in favor, say aye. Any opposed? See that pass 7-0. Congratulations, Don. Congratulations, Mr. Best. And thank you, Mr. Roberts. Appreciate it.
Okay.
Next item is a public hearing. An application submitted by Jeffrey Pavone on behalf of Black Jack's number 10 Beer and Wine Store. Liquor license for its location. Mrs. Reedhead.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. Jeffrey Pavone, representing Black Jack's, has submitted an application for a number 10 Beer and Wine Store liquor license for its location at 4480 East Dusa Clubs in Sholo. This location previously had a number 10 Beer and Wine Store liquor license, but the owners are new, and state law allows only a few types of liquor license to be transferred, and Beer and Wine Store license are not transferable. The property was posted per state law, and no public input was received. Mr. Pavone also applied for an interim permit, which is valid for 105 days. To allow him to sell alcohol while the number 10 application is being processed. If the application is not approved before the interim permit expires, the applicant must request a second interim permit. The Sholo Police Department conducted a background check on the applicant and the other associated individuals and found nothing amiss. The Department of Liquor Licenses and Control will conduct its own internal investigations and background checks. Based on the investigator's findings and the recommendation of the City Council, the State Liquor Board will decide whether to approve or deny the application. If the council chooses to recommend denial of the application, the motion must state the reasons for denial. And Alex Pavone is here tonight if you have any questions.
Thank you. Right at this time, I'll open this up for a public hearing. If there's anybody in the audience who wishes to speak concerning this item, may do so at this time. Nobody moved. I'll close the public hearing and bring it back to council for a motion. Vice Mayor.
Thank you, Mayor. I move to recommend approval of the State Liquor Board of an application submitted by Jeffrey Provost on behalf of the Black Jack's number 10 Beer and Wine Store liquor license for its location at 480 East Dusa Club, Sholo, Arizona.
Thank you. We have a motion. Is there a second? Second by Councilmember Leach. Any other discussion? Seeing none, I'll call for the vote. All those in favor? Any opposed? I see that passed 7-0. Thank you on that. Appreciate it. Next item is item 8D, a consideration of resolution number R2020-10, approving intergovernmental agreement with Timber Mesa Fire and Medical District. Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. On December 2nd, 2015, the City and Timber Mesa Fire and Medical District approved an intergovernmental agreement that combines several IGAs between the City and Fire District into one IGA. Approximately a year ago, the Fire District approached the City about renegotiating certain terms of the IGA, including the costs associated with the aircraft rescue firefighting services, or ARF services, at the airport. Parties negotiated for many months and were able to agree on most of the changes, but the compensation for the ARF services remained at an impasse. On March 23, 2020, the Fire District gave notice that they were canceling the IGA effective June 23, 2020 and rejected the latest proposal from the City. Thereafter, the City advertised for a request for proposals for ARF services at the airport and received 5 proposals. In the interim, the City and the Fire District continued to discuss a resolution. The City gave a final proposal to the Fire District on May 21st. On Wednesday, May 27th, Timber Mesa Fire and Medical District Board approved the recent proposal from the City, which is attached as the IGA. This agreement states that the City will pay $75,000 to Timber Mesa in this fiscal year, $150,000 in fiscal year 2021, and $178,000 in fiscal year 2022. In succeeding years, the amount will be increased by the Consumer Price Index for the Western region of the United States. The IJ also contains language that the City will be responsible for the repairs to the ARF fire trucks and the foam for the trucks. In addition, there is language for doing joint training for emergency operations, language that addresses the use of the City water system, fire hydrants, that the City will assist with snow removal when requested by the Fire District. So staff recommends approving the IGA with the Timber Mesa Fire and Medical District. There was an error in that last sentence. There's no need to do anything with the request for proposals.
Thank you.
And I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Any comments or questions? Seeing none, I'll look for a motion. Councilmember Kakavas.
I move to adopt resolution number R2020-10, approving an intergovernmental agreement with Timber Mesa Fire and Medical District.
There's a motion. Is there a second? Second by Councilmember Clark. Any other discussion? Call for the vote. All those in favor? Any opposed? That passed 7-0. Thank you. I want to thank our staff and, you know, for the efforts that they put forth in working with this. We also want to thank our partners there with Timber Mesa for this agreement, and we hope we'll continue to have the intergovernmental agreement that we've had for many years as we go forward. Thank you. Next item we have is a summary of current events. I look to council members for any current event they'd like to share. Councilwoman Kakavas.
Mayor, in response to some of the statements earlier regarding Freedom Fest, I think there's some information that our community needs to consider. It wasn't an easy decision to enter into to cancel that that program. But currently at Summit Healthcare, we have 8 positive COVID patients, 10 inpatients that are pending results for their tests, but they're serious enough to be inpatient. So we have 18 patients in the hospital currently. When this started a number of weeks ago, we didn't have any, but our area is seeing quite the surge right now. We have 83 pending tests. We have 86 total in the, this is just for Summit, 86 positive COVID patients. We have 1,378 negative tests. So that number is rising, and we need to be cautious and conscious of that in our community. The Navajo County Health Department is saying that our surge or where we'll max out is June 14th. And that's just when we're going to see the peak. And so this isn't over for us by any means. We still need to be cautious and stay safe. do social distancing and follow the guidelines of the CDC.
Thank you. Any other council members? Vice Mayor?
Thank you, Mayor. Just want to let everybody know that theoretically, June 1st, the Aquatic Center and a library and a lot of stuff opened up here in the city of Sholo. We have a number of people who can go in the library at a certain time, and there's new restrictions at the Aquatic Center of how many people can be there and swimming and all the different aerobic classes and everything else and how that's going to work. I am grateful for staff, city manager down to open up these things in the city and get things rolling again. Just like Councilman Kunkava said, you know, just it's scary to do some of this stuff, but we have to do something. We have to get things going. We have to get people back into some type of norm. And so I just wanted to thank staff for starting to open up stuff and getting things ready for everybody. So appreciate that.
Thank you. Anyone else? Just want to share a couple of things, the updates that we have the opportunity of talking with Supervisor Donna Faye White Singer of District 5. I want to bring our attention that we are good neighbors and we are good, friendly people. And we reached out to Mayor Irwin after talking with her, after she shared that there's 739 cases on the White Mountain Apache tribe. And she says that one of their main concerns they have is when people test positive for COVID-19, they need to immediately go into quarantine. And they don't have the opportunity necessarily to get supplies. And so reaching out with Mayor Irwin of Pinetop Lakeside and also with the city of Sholo, we would like to put together a drive of needs of care boxes for assistance here with our neighbors of the White Mountain Apache tribe. June 11th is the date that has been selected that we will collect those items. We'll be collecting them here at the Sholo City Hall, as well as the Blue Ridge High School. And so you can put together a care box. Those items of the care box are bleach, cleaning supplies, hand sanitizers, disinfectant wipes, gloves, hand soaps or liquid soaps, masks, cloth masks, trash bags, bottled water, paper products, food boxes, Gatorade, mop heads, mop stick, brooms, rags, laundry soap, baby diapers, and dustpans. Those are the things that they need most to be able to go back to their homes, to be able to do cleaning, be able to not have to go to the stores, and to get them by for the next couple of months. So we hope that we'll rally around as our community, as we have people who need some help and assistance, that we'll mark June 11th to try to put some of those boxes together. Just put some boxes together, drop them off here by the city hall. We'll have a collection area, and then we'll see that they are passed on. And we'll be doing more of this on social media and sharing. I just want to thank our citizens. I want to thank our police department for the reaction and for the things that they've done with the curfews that we have. I think we need to hurry and be done here in about 2 minutes so we can go home before curfew. But at the same time, we're grateful for how we've responded and how everybody in the country that we live in and the area we live in, that we can feel safe. And so I know Chief is going to share a little bit more on that, and I'll turn the time now to our city manager and for Chief to share a little bit more.
I just have a few things to report. This is the final week for the Project Clean Sweep project. It's bulky item pickup on your regularly scheduled trash day. So if your trash day is Wednesday or Thursday, you can still put stuff by the curb and the city crews will pick it up. Saturday, June 6th is the last day you can haul the debris free to Lone Pine Transfer Station from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. It's closed from noon to 12:30 for lunch. You need to take your city utility bill showing refuse service and valid driver's license, or a valid driver's license showing your physical address in the city. You need more information on that, you can call 532-4100. And in public works projects, our contractor will begin slurry sealing later this week of some public city parking lots. And then they'll start on the selected streets next Monday, June 8th. The project is scheduled to last approximately 4 weeks. The schedule is posted on the city's website. It's subject to change if weather conditions change. If it starts raining, they'll have to postpone some of those. We hope it does start raining. Crews will notify affected residents 2 days prior to the project beginning in their neighborhood. We also want to advise the public and that work's begun on the North 16th Avenue sidewalk and walking path from West McNeil to Old Linden Road. And as always, we appreciate the citizens' patience as we make improvements to the city. Just to add a little bit more to what Vice Mayor mentioned about Aquatic Center and the library, the Aquatic Center reopened yesterday in a phased approach to ensure public safety. It is important for our customers to understand that operations will be temporarily different, and we ask for patience with the changes and with patience with our staff as they keep the public safe. A detailed reopening plan is available to read at the Aquatic Center, and it's also posted on our city website at sholoaz.gov. And again, you can call, if there's questions, you can call 532-4130. That's Aquatic Center number. And the library reopened yesterday, as has been mentioned, with new temporary hours, which are Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. Only 75 people at a time will be allowed in the library. And computer time will be limited to 60 minutes per session per day, per person per day. Patrons will not be required to wear masks, but will need to follow social distancing guidelines. The library held a drive-by summer reading kickoff last Friday, and 169 registered to participate. This year's theme on the on that program is Imagine Your Story, and it will be an online summer reading program. There's still some time to sign up for that program. You can call 532-4070 for information on that. And finally, the recreation staff is accepting registrations for Pee Wee T-Ball through June 30th for kids ages 3 to 6. The play is tentatively scheduled to begin on July 6th. I want to turn a couple minutes over to Chief Shelley, who will be talking about the latest governor's executive order on the curfew.
Thank you, City Manager.
Mayor and City Council. So when the COVID-19 came out, when we started going through all the processes and all the CDC guidelines, we took an approach of education, kind of a patient educational process with all the businesses and all the people that were out there. We're doing the same thing with this one. And the reason for that is, you said 2 minutes, and actually, this is one of the exceptions to the rule that these kind of meetings are okay to do and are okay to go to. So with that being said, Governor Ducey issued a statewide declaration of emergency, including putting in place curfew starting 8 p.m. on Sunday night. The curfew is in effect each day, 8 to 5, and will expire on Monday, June 8th at 5 a.m., unless further extended. While the Sholo Police Department fully supports and understands this order, we also understand the community's concern. Governor's order is intended to keep the peace and to protect life and property. It's not intended to interfere with everyday activities. It allows people to go shop, go out to eat, go to church, seek medical help, go to a council meeting, whatever you'd like to. But Sholo is fortunate not to have experienced a lot of the civil unrest seen in other parts of the state, but also the governor's order is meant to address widespread and rapidly changing situation. So as always, we always stand behind the governor's orders that we can't pick and choose these things. These are lawful orders. And we just want to make sure that everybody understands you can still go about your normal business out there. You can go to your family's house or your friend's house. You just can't do unlawful activity. If you do, well, then we'll step in. And that's pretty much what it was. Any questions for that?
Thank you.
Very good.
Pretty simple.
Appreciate it.
Very good. Thank you.
You know, one of the hardest things that happens during the COVID-19 is when we have a member of a family or a community who passes away. And during the social distancing and the guidelines that are in place, we can't even have a funeral. And recently we lost a good citizen in our community, Larry Whipple. And he's had a battle for a long, long time. But anybody who's an old timer in this area knows that Larry was over the ditch boss. He was a ditch boss for many years and worked very hard to help. I believe he sold some of his property to help Sholo High School, where the school was. Used to be some of Whipple's property and stuff. So we just give our condolences to his family, to his departed the loved ones as well. And he will have there'll be a graveside service this Saturday at 10 a.m. at the Sholo Cemetery. So, citizens to know that. Any other items or scheduling of meetings? We just encourage you to reach back out with Tamara on the dates of our retreat in October. Let her know what may or may not work for those dates that we have coming up. This time, seeing no other business, I want to thank those who are here tonight and those who have taken part, and I'll adjourn this meeting.